Hi.
And we're here with Judy Chicago and in Santa Monica, California, and the date is April
13th.
Okay. So Judy, you know, what I would like to start out with is just getting a sense of what Los Angeles was like in 1957 when you came here to attend UCLA.
Well, Los Angeles as a place was paradise. Blue sky, no smog, easy to get around on the freeways, although I didn't drive for a couple of years. And it was a wonderful place in terms of going to school. There was a lot of freedom. But I left for a year in 1959. I went to New York for a year and went to study at the new school. Thought I might move to New York, but I was living in the East Village before it was popular. And there were all these wannabe everythings, wannabe artists, wannabe poets, wannabe dancers, wannabe musicians. And mostly they sat around smoking pot and doing nothing. I got up every morning and worked at the Police Athletic League and at somewhere else. I had a part-time teaching job, teaching art, and then I went to the New School. But I absorbed abstract expressionism at that time. But I decided to go back to school. I didn't want to be with all those wannabes. And went back to UCLA for another 2 years and then went to graduate school at UCLA. And when I got into graduate school, I began to run up against a lot of gender bias in the department, in the art department. The male faculty hated my paintings. And in fact, one of them said, "Oh, they look like wombs and breasts." You know, I was like, "Oh, how disgusting." And so consequently, I began to excise my work of any markings of gender. And the one thing that happened when I was in graduate school was that Billy L. Bengtson came to teach for a year. And I knew as soon as I met him, I didn't study with him, but I hung around him because I knew he was like a real artist, not like my teachers. And I actually learned about what it meant to be a serious artist through Billy L. His studio was the first studio I ever visited, and I can still remember him saying, "Yeah, when I get up on the first of every month, it's $700 before I even open my eyes." I'm like, $700? I also learned about the something's gonna happen way of living, which is how I live my life. And it was very unusual for a woman to do that at that time. You know, I didn't have a full-time job. I got out of graduate school and made my way with part-time teaching. By then I was showing at Ralph Nelson, and so occasional sales and something's gonna happen every month.
Who were some of the professors and some of your fellow students when you were going to UCLA?
Well, there were a lot of people who I was in school with, even though I didn't know them that well. Henry Hopkins was there. He was ahead of me. He was older than me. He was a returning vet in the art history department. And John Bullard was also there, who became the director, longtime director of the New Orleans Museum. And then there were some younger people, of course, in my there was a woman named, I forgot her last name, but she married Francis Ford Coppola, Ellie Coppola. She was in the design department. Marvin Harden was at school with me. Lance Richburg, I don't know what happened to him. Of course, Lloyd Hamrell was at school. Tony Berlant. There was a whole sort of group of us. I was, of course, the only woman. And I gravitated out of the painting department into the sculpture department with Oliver Andrews because he was one of the few professors who supported women. And I didn't realize at the time that it was unusual to have an assistantship in sculpture. But in 1963, I'm not sure there were very many women in graduate schools around the country who had teaching assistantships in sculpture. And so I graduated with a degree in both painting and sculpture.
Was Via Selman in your
class? Yeah, Via was younger. She was a little later than me. Via actually wasn't visible in the 60s or the 70s. She got sort of written in later. She was around, but I think it wasn't until the 80s that she began to get really kind of more established.
How did your first show with Ralph Nelson come about?
You know, my first show, by the time I had my first solo show, which was open on New Year's Eve, 1965, 66, I'd been showing with Rolf, you know, in group shows. The whole art scene was really different when I got out of school. First of all, there was just the very beginnings of an art scene. You know, the first galleries had opened, Dwan, Rolf Nelson, Ferris, and Art Forum in 1965 moved down from San Francisco. So everybody kind of knew everybody. You know, all the Ferris guys hung out at Barney's Beanery. I used to hang out with them, you know, much to their chagrin. And on Saturdays, there was this La Cienega stroll where everybody would go down and go see the galleries, what few there were. And also, I mean, there was no really idea of making money from art. Everybody had this idea that, you know, if you could be taken seriously as an artist, that was the goal. And so, you know, we all hung out. I don't remember how I happened to be in the first group shows with Rolf Nelson. I was very ambitious. And so, you know, I was like out there trying to get my work shown and seen. And the two people who kind of championed my work in the 60s were Rolf and John Copeland's. At the same time, John used to say all the time, you can't be a woman and an artist too. So it was always contingent. I mean, my visibility, my acceptance was always marginal and contingent. And also, there was this thing about, like, you never wanted to be seen if you were a woman doing any domestic tasks. Like, if anybody came to your studio, you didn't want to be making tea or ironing or sewing or doing anything that would kind of mark you. Because, you know, like, the worst thing you could be is a pussy in that context.
I mean, so much of what we think of that was happening at that time in L.A. was really around the Ferris guys and this macho scene. I mean, even consider, there's not that many women artists that we know of at that time who were showing.
There weren't any. I mean, yeah, well, there were some. There was Carol Sarkeesian, but then she sort of, you know, went off in a different direction. She and Paul moved to New Mexico, and she's only started making art again. For a long time, she was doing basket repair, you know, Indian basket repair. There were a couple. I mean, there was June Wayne. But she, oh my God, the men used to say terrible things about June, just terrible. And there were two female teachers at UCLA when I was there who were tenured, that was two more than there were going to be for 20 years. That was Dorothy Brown and Anita Delano. But, you know, I had already internalized the idea of not associating with women. And so I didn't study with them. Anita Delano had studied with John Dewey and was probably a wonderful teacher, but I distanced myself from them and couldn't understand why Brown had a collection of women's art, which she did. Because, of course, there was the same institutional failure then that there is now, which is transmitting the history of women's struggle for aesthetic equity and freedom. And so I didn't learn anything about it, and just like young women don't learn today, and that's why they distance themselves from feminism, because they haven't learned that history, and therefore they're not proud of it, just like I wasn't.
What was the work that was shown at Rolf Nelson in that show?
Well, the first things I showed were things I did in graduate school: painted sculptures, small, you know, drawings, and what the show I had, the first solo show I had at Rolf Nelson, was in two parts, because they were both large-scale sculptures and only one at a time would fit in the gallery. So I can't remember which sequence they were in, but one was Sunset Squares, which then resided in the Grinstein's anteroom, like entryway, for a long time until it started falling apart. And then I said, oh, well, let's just destroy it since it wasn't looking so hot. And Rainbow Picket. Now, Rainbow Picket has a history of having broken my heart. When I first did Rainbow Picket, it was in my studio, And Walter Hopps, who of course was the most powerful curator in Southern California, I was living and working in Pasadena, and there were a whole bunch of us in Pasadena. I had found a studio for Ron Davis and brought him down, and from San Francisco I found a studio for Mark DeSouvreau. He was next door. So there were a lot of artists living and working. Bruce Nauman was around the corner, but he didn't really, he wasn't very connected to the LA art scene. He kind of worked apart. Anyway, so Walter used to go visit all the studios once a month in Pasadena. And he arrived right after I finished Rainbow Picket, and I wanted him to look at it. And he just refused to look at it. He walked over to a piece by my ex-husband, Lloyd Hamrolls, and said, "Oh, have you changed the color?" He hadn't changed the color. And I mean, I just was heartbroken, refused to look at it. Then, because of Rolf, Rainbow Picket went to the Primary Structure show. And see, even then, I mean, I was so naive and, you know, not plugged in the sense that nobody told me how the art scene worked. I didn't know when you're in a major show in New York, you're supposed to get on the airplane and go to the opening. So, you know, I didn't even know what Primary Structures was. I didn't realize the impact of it. And I think somebody told me recently, I think there were only four women in the entire show, maybe three. And Clement Greenberg singled out, was walking around the show with Walter, and sort of singled out that piece. And Walter, "Oh, well, I know her, I visit her all the time," in neglecting totally to mention that he had refused to look at the piece or acknowledge it or do anything. So, you know, I was making all this large-scale work and kind of getting nowhere with it in the LA art scene. It was getting shown, but it wasn't getting sold, it wasn't getting placed. So I was getting stuck with a lot of big sculpture. And so I, like my first work in graduate school, my paintings and stuff, I destroyed those, and I destroyed a lot of that large-scale sculpture, including Rainbow Picket. And I did think to myself, you know, maybe there will come a time when people are interested in this work from my first decade of professional practice. So I did put a certain amount away in storage and just left it there, and it stayed there for 30 years unlooked at and unseen and unknown. I ran into Walter some years after that, after I'd published Through the Flower, my first book, and I didn't mention him by name in the book, but I guess he had read it and he knew that it was him because I told the story. And we were having breakfast, I think in Washington, he was at the Hirshhorn, or in some kind of appointment there after he'd kind of left Southern California. And he said to me, "I know you hated me, Judy." He said, "But what was I supposed to do? I mean, in those days, women were either groupies or artists' wives. So how was I supposed to deal with the fact that you were making art that was stronger than a lot of the men's?" It was like seeing a woman who pulled up her skirt and rolled down her stockings. I had to avert my eyes. And he expected me to forgive him, you know. I got a lot of pleasure years later when I ran into Walter and his third wife, and I met her, and she said, "Oh, I'm a great fan of your work." But anyway, then Rainbow Picket was reconstructed for the MoCA Minimal show and became the kind of signature piece for, you know, there was a big 50-foot banner on the front of the museum with Rainbow Picket, and every time the show was talked about, it was featured in the articles. And, you know, it was a far cry from when Peter Plagens wrote in Art Forum about that work. It didn't have the guns, which you got to say is a deeply gender-rooted comment, right? Deeply. So I was encountering all of this, you know, during those years and struggling against it and trying to figure out how to make a place for myself.
And that pressure, I mean, really influenced your work and exactly what you were making, and, you know, the idea of doing, you know, kind of stripping color out of your work at some point.
Well, in UCLA, they used to tell me I had a terrible color sense because, you know, UCLA was dominated by the browns and earth tones in the paintings. That was the prevailing view of what a painting should look like. So here I am with like turquoise and orange and cream color and, you know, pastel shades, and oh God, they just hated it. They hated my content, they hated my color.
When, like, when you think about that now, you think about the mindset that you were in then. Can you kind of explain that a little bit to us about what was it? Was it because you didn't have enough storage? Was it because?
Well, if I was having shows, okay. So here I am having shows. You know, I'm, my work is getting written about, but it's not being translated into any kind of substantive institutional support. No sales, you know, no major sales. I was selling small work, but no major sales, no major curatorial support, no major critical support. And instead, you know, John Copeland would write sometimes positively about me, but for him it was a quandary. You know, he could see I had talent, but it was in the wrong body. So even when he gave me a show at the Pasadena Museum, which he did, of my domes, you know, instead of doing the catalog and writing the catalog, I said he made me do my own catalog. And you know, meanwhile, all the guys are, you know, they're getting the apparatus moving them along. I wasn't getting any of that. I was always having to start over again. Wherever I'd get a ways, and then I'd have to stop. And actually, I was thinking about my disappearing environments, since I'm restaging and reconfiguring some of the pieces I did during those years, I was thinking about the difference between them and some of the work like the dematerialized objects, Bob Irwin and stuff like that. But I was literally trying to either transform the environment or dematerialize the opposition that I was facing. So there was a lot of hidden content in all of that work. And it was of a tremendous satisfaction to me years later, actually, when young scholars like Jenni, Sorkin came to me and they could read the hidden content in some of that minimal work, like in Passing the Lifesavers. And she told me that her generation were really interested in that work. Well, that was just a complete revelation to me. And as I said to her, had that, what I was doing, been clear at the time, I might not have made the radical break that I made. On the other hand, then feminist art wouldn't have been born. So there you go.
Can you talk a little bit about the sort of the, when you say dematerialized and the atmosphere pieces, there's this shift in which the color disperses, the color lingers in the air and then it disperses. Could you talk about how that relates to your painting practice? Because you were doing the two things simultaneously.
Yeah, Ken, could you talk to Rani?
You can move over.
Yeah, move over. Does that work?
That works.
Okay. Actually, it's interesting, when the Getty people came, you know, you were looking at my color book, because I spent a lot of time when I got out of graduate school developing color theory, where color, I looked at how color could create emotive states. And the way I laid out my paintings, or the domes, the color in Passing the Lifesavers, or the dome paintings, or the dome sculptures. That was a lot how I laid out the color for my atmospheres. Same way. Except that, for example, if you think about the form domes, where there was color in layers at different levels, it was like that system of color was released from inside that container. So it was, one, a liberatory gesture. And two, it was about trying to soften or feminize the environment, even for just a moment, where instead of it being a wall of resistance, it became an enveloping, beautiful space.
But then in your work, you went back to recapturing the color within the space of the grid. So how does that relate to this idea of how can you be both liberatory and gridded, I guess?
Well, I suppose that was one of the things I was trying to deal with. How could I be myself within the constraints of a system, an art system, that didn't serve me? Okay? But if you think about the dates of the atmospheres. I mean, I was doing the domes in the late 60s, and that was the point at which I started the atmospheres. And then they continued into the early 70s until 72. I only stopped them because, again, I couldn't get support to go farther and to go bigger, which I was always my impulse. And it was during those years that I found my way to a different kind of practice.
And what does it mean to have the opportunity to go big now and recreate one of these pieces?
Well, I'm actually picking up where I left off. I'm actually not recreating anything. I'm picking up exactly where I left off in 1972 when I did the last fireworks piece, which was a butterfly for Oakland. And I'm picking right up there and doing a butterfly for Pomona. And the difference, the biggest difference is, of course, in the late 60s and early 70s, I and my friends just went out. I bought fireworks, laid them out according to my color wheel systems, and me and my friend just went out and lit them, and everybody did something. It was already it was all participatory. Everybody who went either lit flares or they cooked, brought food, or they took pictures. And now that's totally impossible. Like, I'm doing the butterfly for Pomona reaches back to the early 70s when I was the only woman in the 2 years that Hal Glicksman ran the program there, where I did atmosphere in Mount Baldy. Can you imagine being able to go up and light fireworks in Mount Baldy now? It's out of the question. And so now it's different. I mean, it's a different challenge because now I'm designing the fireworks piece as opposed to doing it myself. So not only am I picking up where I left off, but I'm doing it in a different way. And what is it like? As I told Glenn, it's probably the first time in my life that I've had this kind of opportunity brought to me by a curator.
To go back just a little bit.
Oh, the car hood?
Discussing materiality and the struggle to find a form, you know, for what you're working. If you could maybe give us a little bit of backstory about the car hood and just describe it in detail in terms of the imagery.
Okay, so there I am in graduate school, starting to try and figure out how to make a place for myself in this unbelievably macho environment. And I met John Chamberlain at the time. And John, anyway, we used to hang out some. And John used to say, well, what I really should do is go learn how to spray paint from those auto body people. Because he was very crude. His spray painting actually was very crude. And of course, you know, we all used to go out and watch Billy Al ride motorcycles. So, and there was this whole thing about car culture. And now here I am. I know nothing about, you know, like building, or I have no orientation towards any of this. You know, I was raised in a Jewish intellectual family, you know, where doing physical work is like sort of not in your mind. But I was always very physical, and I really discovered that when I was in graduate school, you know, that I really liked making things, actually making things. So I decided after I got out of graduate school that I would go to auto body school and learn to spray paint. So I went, me and 250 guys. They're all they're all being paid to go because they're getting like, you know, veterans benefits or retraining things, or they're all getting paid. Me, I'm paying, which of course, you know, I say I spent a lot of years paying to work. So they made me wear this long white, I don't know what it was. They weren't overalls. It was like a smock, you know, from here to here. I used to joke, I'd say, yeah, right, if I bend over and some like glimpse of breast is exposed, oh my God, they're all going to drop dead because none of them ever seen one before, right? So the summer I got out of graduate school, I spent at auto body school, and it was a revelation to me. I still remember my painting teacher, Percy Jeffries, who drove a lavender convertible, candy apple. And I was quoting him yesterday, actually, in Pomona. He used to say there's no such thing as perfection, there's only the illusion of perfection, and that's what the goal is to create that illusion. And that was the first time when I was in auto body school that I actually began to understand that art making is making objects, making physical objects. And I learned a kind of attitude towards object making in auto body school, as well as how to spray paint, which has served me well because I've sprayed everything over the years. And so while I was at auto body school, I did the car hood, and of course only later did I think about the perfect symbolism of the car hood in terms of this kind of still somewhat disguised but still female form applied to a car hood. So there you go, about trying to merge my own impulses with a restrictive form.
Did Billy Al ever see the car hood or comment?
I don't know. Billy Al did. I don't know if Billy Al did. I'll tell you who did, not this, but who did see my work at that time. I mean, other than small people. Oh, they never talked. They never said anything about my work, except the only person who ever did was Bob Irwin. He came to my graduate show at UCLA, and it was painting and sculpture, and I still remember what he said. He said, something about, it had to do with how vulnerable I was and how he could really wipe me out in one moment, but he wasn't going to.
So he was slightly threatened, you felt, or we don't know?
I don't know. It'd be interesting. I have no idea, since those guys, you know, I mean, I was telling the story at dinner last night with Glenn, you know, I hadn't seen Billy Al for years and years, and I saw him at the party at the Grinsteins when Henry Hopkins stepped down from UCLA and from the Hammer, and I walked up to him and I said, Billy Al, I'm glad to see you. I've always wanted to thank you, you know, because I really did learn a lot from you, I mean, even though he was a macho pig. But anyway, he said, oh yeah, Judy, I know. It's because I was such a male chauvinist that you did what you did. And I'm like, don't take all the credit or all the blame, will you please? They were my earliest patrons.
Can you start by saying their name?
Stanley and Elise Grinstein were my earliest patrons, and they remained very good friends of mine and supporters of mine over many, many decades, you know, in the face of a lot of criticism, not only of me, but of everybody who supported me. And I met them at a party for Larry Bell. And I met Stanley first. And he started yelling for Elise, because at that time I was making these movable game boards, and I had, some of them were in, they were in all different materials, wood, metal, then acrylic, but these were in wood, and I had bought game board pieces, you know, that came like kids' games, like, you know, little blocks and stuff, all different shapes. But I had developed the surface on them. And Elise apparently had seen one of these game boards at Rolf's and wanted to buy it, but it was $700, and she thought that was too much, so she decided she'd make it herself. And Stanley says, well, Elise is trying to make your game boards, but you can't get the surfaces. Would you please tell her how? And Elise, of course, was mortified. You know, Stanley, how could you say that? How could you say that? But anyway, a few weeks later, they came to visit me in Pasadena. I remember it so distinctly. They came to visit, and in the loft I shared with two other artists in Pasadena, it was on top of a bank building. We paid, this gives you some idea of what it was like in those days. It was 5,000 square feet, and the three of us together paid $75 a month rent. So our rent was $25 a month each, okay? But it was a bank building, so that meant, you know, there were rooms all around the central stairway. And the room I used for kitchen didn't have any water in it, running water. So in order to do dishes, you'd have to I had a shopping cart that I used to take to the bathroom to wash the dishes, okay? So Stan and Elise come, and I've never been a materialist person. person, so it never sort of crossed my mind that my dishes didn't match and they were all ragtag used dishes. But, you know, I'm a Jewish middle-class girl, so of course I have to serve something. So I guess Elise and Stanley saw my ragtag collection of dishes. And a couple weeks later, this big box arrives, and it's a complete setting for eight, play setting of white Japanese porcelain, which was my first set of dishes that matched. And I used to go downtown and meet Stanley, you know, out on Alameda near my friend Bowman, which was a forklift company, which is what where he worked, he owned. And we used to go to this restaurant. I think it was called the Palomino or something. And anyway, there were these red Naga hide booths, and we'd have these heart-to-heart talks, and, you know, Stanley wanted to know what I was working on. And the thing about the Grinsteins was that, you know, they became really involved with artists, to the extent that Stanley would set up accounts where you that would help you be able to make art. And, you know, a lot of their collection comes out of the gratitude of the artists. There's a lot of art in Southern California that would not have been made without the Grinsteins. And one of the Grinsteins' daughters is actually making a film about the family now. And so I just did an interview with them on Saturday about that. We were talking about that, about how they helped so many artists in Southern California. And then when I married Donald 25 years ago, Stanley and Elise came to the wedding, and Stanley said, "Now I've married my fourth daughter." So, I mean, that they've been like family to me.
Well, I read somewhere Elise said after she met you that she stop wearing matching shoes and matching purses.
Is that what she said? Well, I tell this story in the interview where after, you know, I gave my first talk on what I, that was my struggle as a woman artist in their living room in 1971, which became the, sort of the beginning of my first book, Through the Flower. And after that, Elise said to me, "Well, I'll support you, Judy, but don't expect me to follow you. Don't expect me to follow you." And it was not very many years later with that, you know, she was like the mommy to the artist. She used to do everything for them. They'd stay at their house. Elise would take them around and drive them and cater to them. She stopped doing all of that, went back to architecture school, became an architect, and went to work with Frank Gehry. So.
And did you use their forklifts?
No, I never used their forklift. But actually, when we moved into Berlin and Donald told Stanley we needed a forklift, he said, "Well, if you can get it there, I'll give you one." And so people who come to visit us and see our forklift are very impressed. It's like the Grinstein Memorial Forklift.
What was the address of the studio in Pasadena?
It was the corner of Raymond and Colorado, overlooking the Rose Bowl parade. In fact, every year we'd have a party there, you know, on the night of the Rose Bowl. And one year, Stanley decided to hire a chef to cook for everybody. Now imagine this guy in a chef's outfit with a chef's hat having to take the cart, shopping cart with the dishes to wash the dishes while in between cooking. And also then, you know, people used to, I guess they still do, line the streets all night before, you know, waiting for the Rose Bowl parade, bringing TVs and camp stoves, stuff like that. And that was, I thought it would be interesting to try and do some kind of event in relationship to that, and that thus the Raymond Rose ritual environment was born, where we closed off Raymond Avenue and did all these performances, events. There was a film on the buildings with screens, and that was actually the beginning of one of my atmospheres, my interest in fireworks, because I lined the streets with road flares, and there was all this smoke, and I did a color wheel on a Klieg light, and the smoke rose up, and the color wheel changed the colors of the smoke. And I'm like, that's really interesting. I think I'll do some colored smoke. And that's how I started doing fireworks pieces, first in Brookside Park in Pasadena as part of these artists' events. We did three of them in Brookside Park, where all the different artists, everybody came, brought food, did events. Sam Francis and Jim Terrell did events. Jim Terrell stole this turkey. This is such a great story. There was this art historian named Kurt von Meyer who was doing a performance. He was sitting zazen, and he had, like, I don't know if, I can't remember if he had a fire or anything, but anyway, he had brought a turkey he was going to sacrifice, and everybody was all upset about it. So while he was in his trance, Jim Terrell stole the turkey and ran off in the white convertible of a music and art collector named Betty Friedman. And of course, the turkey was terrified. And by the time, wherever Jim took it, by the time it got there, the white convertible wasn't quite so white. And then Jim told me recently that Kurt tried to chase them to catch the turkey, but he'd been sitting zazen for so long his legs fell asleep and so he couldn't. Anyway, but I mean, those are the kind of events. So at the same time, you know, as I'm complaining bitterly about the macho environment of LA in the 60s, at the same time, because we were not in New York and the spirit and the shadow of New of Europe was not on us and there was no international art market yet, there was the possibility for self-invention, the possibility for experimentation, the possibility for designing your own path. Because there weren't any, like, this is the path you have to be on, except for the fact that you shouldn't be a girl. But still, I mean, I could not have done what I've done in New York. It's only because it was Los Angeles and there was this freedom here.
And because of that freedom, would you say that's what this sort of collegiality that you're describing and a sort of environment of both institutionalized and casual sexism is what led you to sort of the ability to or the freedom to establish a kind of feminist orientation in a pedagogical sense?
Well, by the, I mean, my the feminist art program for me was always the first step in figuring out how to create a feminist art practice. That was what I saw it as even then. I just didn't know how to do it, and there wasn't such a thing anyway. You know, I always laugh when people say, you know, don't you find it confining to be called a feminist artist? And I'm like, what do you think? That category has existed for the last 200 years? You know, it was invented, and it was invented in the 1970s. And for many of us, it was an incredible path to freedom and aesthetic expression in our own terms. And so why would I find it confining? I found it liberating to be able to be myself.
But how did that mean that you had to break from this sort of larger art scene that you're describing?
I did break from it. I mean, at the same time, I'm telling you that the probably basic framework of my approach to art making in terms of my respect for craft, my interest in translucency, transparency, surface, beauty, that came out of my coming up in California. But at the same time, by the end of my first decade of professional practice, I was just completely fed up. I was fed up with being told I couldn't be a woman and an artist too. I was fed up with the idea that no matter what I did, I couldn't get anywhere. You know, I couldn't get any institutional support. And then the women's movement started, and I saw that it meant that I could be myself. But I didn't know how, because I'd so disconnected my impulses from, you know, myself. In order to be taken seriously, I had disconnected from my natural impulses. All those breasts and wombs, you know, I mean. So I had to figure out how to reconnect without sacrificing the formal control I had developed in the first 10 years of my career. I mean, for a little while, and that is when I started experimenting with different forms, performance, more graphic, you know, Red Flag, the early openly feminist images. You know, I was looking to see if I wanted to dramatically change my form language, if I wanted to go in a completely different direction, and then I decided, no, what I wanted to do was fuse my content with the form language I had developed. But I didn't know how to do it. And So I thought, I have to go away. I mean, I just have to go away to figure this out. I was also in the throes of my early research on women's history and discovering that there was this whole history that that I knew nothing about. And I wanted the time to look at it. I read through all women's novels systematically, looked for women's art, read women's biographies. I had a lot of thinking to do, and I wanted to figure out how to reconnect to my own impulses. So I thought, well, if I teach young women and I help them make art without having to do what I did, which was disconnect from who they are as women, you know, be themselves, be able to be themselves and build a professional art practice on that basis instead of disconnecting, maybe I can figure out how to reconnect myself. But that took a couple of years. It took the Fresno program, CalArts, and even starting the women's building, building a community, discovering that bureaucracy is not something that only men invent. That was a shock to me. I was like, oh, it's only men. It's because of men that institutions are bureaucratic. So then I start my own damn institution, the women's building, and some young woman says to me, well, Judy, there are rules and regulations and you can't just do what you want. And I'm like, oh, really? I started this damn building and I can't? Oh, I guess it's not just men who create bureaucracies. Whoops! Anyway, so then, you know, it took me about 4 years. Meanwhile, I was studying China painting. I was laying down the beginnings of, I was trying, like, for example, in the flesh garden paintings, like Big Blue Pink, I was trying to figure out there how to open up my imagery. And then, of course, I found my way. Big Blue Pink comes from a series of, I did it when I was in Fresno while I was working on the, while I was developing the first feminist art program in Fresno. It's an 8x8 foot sprayed acrylic painting and acrylic lacquer. I had a studio outside of Fresno in Kingsburg, a small town, an old market. And there was in the meat locker in the back, I turned into my spray booth. And I designed the whole studio specifically to do these paintings in the Fresno fans. And because they were really large, the Fresno fans were 5 by 10 feet sheet acrylic. And the flesh gardens are 8x8, so those are pretty big sheets of plastic that I then had backed so that they float and hang on the wall and float out from the wall. But I had these painting racks built, and the acrylic arrived. I had an assistant. We put the acrylic into the painting racks, and then I had this big easel on wheels that then I could pull the sheet acrylic out, put it on the painting easel, wheel it into my spray booth, tape and spray. Then I'd have to get my assistant to help me turn. The whole easel was built so it could go on its back, because then after I got the image on, I'd spray layer and layer after layer of clear acrylic. It's a typical car painting way of working, where you put clear lacquer on top of the color. And then because it was on acrylic lacquer, the paint actually seeped into the surface and bonded with the acrylic, because I was always interested in this fusion of color and surface. Even when I was in college, I didn't like oil paint. I didn't like applying things onto the canvas. I painted thinly when I painted in acrylic. I liked spraying. That was one of the things I discovered in auto body school. I liked spraying because the paint went on so thinly and merged with the surface of the canvas or the car hood or the acrylic or later on the porcelain in the dinner party or the fabric at the birth project or the glass now. And I've always looked at the surface of a painting or a sculpture as like skin, connected it to my skin and wanted the color and the surface to be completely fused. I didn't want to impose on the surface.
Would you say that that had a relationship at all to like Helen Frankenthaler and the way she used raw canvas, or none of that was, it all came out of Southern California? and this idea of light and translucency and transparency, which to me becomes a metaphor later for the idea of turning the lens toward the art world and trying to find transparent connections or disconnections between where sexism is later.
Or isn't. I mean, I think that's what I was always looking for. Places where I could find space that was not disfigured by sexism. You know, so that first I did that by constructing an all-female space. And although I never intended for feminist art to be seen only by a female audience, I was always very opposed to that idea. I mean, from the beginning in Fresno, when we had our first big show at the end of the year, men were invited. They weren't in the studio, but they were invited to see the art. I always felt like, after all, women have been the viewers of male art for centuries, and we've learned a lot about the human experience from that. Why shouldn't men, you know, have the opportunity to expand their understanding of the human experience by seeing women's art, especially if it's women-centered art as opposed to women working within the mainstream vocabulary?
Could you then disconnect in your studio when you were making these kinds of images, the big blue pink? Was there a purity of experience in the process?
I mean, in my studio, was gender present in my studio? No. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I mean, when I read women artists say, you know, I've read a lot of women artists saying, you know, art has no sex. You know, when I'm in my studio, it's nothing to do with that. Well, I understand that. But like Lucy Laporte says, artists do. Artists have gender. Art may not have gender, but artists have gender. And that informs your relationship with the world, even if it doesn't inform your art.
Were you seeing the work of Helen Pashkian at all?
She was another person who was not very visible. There were women working, but they were working in the shadows. You know, it's like in the early 1970s, when I was working with Dexter Frankel on that show, Visible Invisible, we went around to look for women artists, and there were a lot of women artists working in the back rooms of their boyfriends or husbands' studios. It was a revelation. There were a lot of them, but they were completely not visible. I think it's fantastic that Helen has been able to sustain herself all these years and is finally having her work recognized. But look how long she had to wait.
You figure, you know, she was in Pasadena, just, you know, a mile away from you.
I mean, it's interesting because, you know, I did seek out women artists. I sought out Joan Brown in Northern California and Jada Feo. But in fact, I was recently contacted by a curator from the San Jose Museum who's doing a show on Joan Brown. And there were a couple of things. She wanted to ask me about that period of time and whether Joan, you know, because apparently Joan's family told her that, you know, Joan had some feelings of connection with me. But at the time, she didn't admit it. She was doing the same thing I was. She was fighting for space in a completely male-dominated situation. And, you know, she also, it was dangerous to identify with other women. That doesn't mean that her content did not begin to reflect her experiences as a woman once the feminist art movement started and there was more permission. It did. Her content changed. But when I met her in the late 60s, even though, you know, we were amiable, she couldn't do, for example, what Marisol did when I met her much later in New York in a bar, and she said to me, "Judy, the men hate me." That was the first thing she said to me, "The men hate me." And so it was really interesting, that show on women in the pop art movement that I saw at the Brooklyn Museum. If you read the catalog, it was fascinating because they talked about the generation between, this would be Marisol, the generation between the abstract expressionists, where all the women painted like men, and my generation, where we rebelled and said, screw this, we're going to figure out how to be women. And but the pop artists were stranded between those two generations. And what you read in the history of their life stories, their biographies, is one after another who was derailed. And it got me really angry, this thing about Lee Lozano. Suddenly she's being, you know, like, heroicized. Not that she didn't deserve it. It's just that nobody seems to want to mention the fact that she died penniless, homeless, and ill.
Did you meet Jay DeFeo?
Yes, I met Jay DeFeo.
And what was that
relationship? Well, I met her. See, I was friends with Manuel Neary. And so I'd go up to San Francisco sometimes, and I met Jay at Aunt Manuel's. She was sick already by then. But, you know, like, it was so obvious to me that the rose was a female-centered painting. But it was never discussed that way, ever, ever, ever. She had a hard time, too. And the curator from San Jose Museum was telling me she had just read the Frida Kahlo book, you know, my most recent book, and she talked about how Joan Brown also is written about in relationship to her male partners, as opposed to looking at her work apart from them. And she was very, very happy to see the approach that Frances Borzello and I took in the Kahlo book, which was to not look at Kahlo's book as work as being reactive to Diego Rivera's actions, but rather looking, giving her back her agency as a person, as an artist.
I mean, Jay DeFeo was really actively, you know, exploring her sexuality,
right,
and her body,
and right,
in her work, and really was, I mean, that was so essentially connected to her practice.
Yeah, but it wasn't discussed. In fact, you know, reading content in art was completely out of the vocabulary of the 60s. I remember when I went in and I saw these Craig Kaufman vacuum paintings, and they were all these limp dicks. And I'm like, I'm sorry, he's impotent, geez. I mean, but you couldn't have said that. I mean, they'd all look at you like, what, are you a castrator? I mean, they would have gone crazy. The guys would have gone crazy if you had tried to suggest some kind of gender-laden hidden content in that work. I mean, even Mark DeSouvre, who's always been a good, you know, sort of supportive person to me, after I started talking about the hidden content in Pasadena Lifesavers, he said, Judy, I could look at those paintings all day and it never would occur to me. And actually, that's one of the reasons there's so much confusion about feminist art, and what is feminist art, and is there such a thing as feminist art? Because the art world can't read content. So what they're looking for is feminist art that's stylistically similar. But that's not what feminist art is. What defines feminist art is its content, not its form. But there is still a great resistance to reading content in art.
Well, so talk to us about the content in Big Blue Paint.
It's about trying to expand, open up, let in space, and also about merger of flesh and landscape, and surface and color, as a physical metaphor for that spiritual merging. But it's about trying to open up, let in more space.
In terms of the process, would you say that it took, like, over a period? I know you have to dry the layers.
Actually it's the opposite. Spraying acrylic lacquer is challenging for the absolute opposite reason. You have to stop before you go too far, because you can blow it in a second and a half. So it's a lot of preparation, a lot of taping. Then spraying doesn't take very long, and acrylic lacquer actually dries very quickly. But what's challenging and difficult about it is knowing how much paint to put on, when to stop, and when I would turn it over, then what would take 24 hours is for all that clear to dissolve the paint and dissolve the top surface of the acrylic and merge with it. That just had to sit there for a day.
And how many layers of paint did you end up applying?
How many layers of clear?
Yeah. How many spray?
Each area I would spray until it was done. So they would be taped. So let's say I do all the cool colors at one time and then let them sit for a little bit, then take them off and do the warm colors, and then turn it over and spray layer after layer after layer of clear. I don't know, 8, 10? It's very much like when I was China painting and doing you know, firing after firing, layer after layer of color, building up the color and firing it. And it's a sort of comparable process, although it's different technically, but it's comparable in terms of merging, vitrifying the color onto the surface of the porcelain, the glaze of the porcelain.
And so these were made in Fresno. Can you just explain the transition from Fresno to CalArts and the development of Woman House?
Okay, so here I am in Fresno with the feminist art program, right? We have our own studio. And I'm like 30 years old, right? And some of my students, like Suzanne Lacey and Faith Wilding, they're only like 5 years younger than me. So there's not that big age gap, but I'm the teacher and they're the students, right? And they're dependent on me for support. And all of this, like, energy is coming out, this bottled up subject matter energy, you know, it's kind of terrifying. And at the same time, I didn't want to at all impede it. So I really needed some help and some support myself. And I didn't really know who I could turn to. So I had met Miriam Shapiro in San Diego at a party. And out of the blue, I just called her up. I read her painting. I could see her painting, like Ox had a very similar impulse as Passing the Lifesavers. It was like J. DeFeo's Rose. I mean, I just knew that that all that work was coming out of some effort to find a language that one could speak about one's life experience as a woman as well as a visual person. And so I just called her up and told her what I was doing. Although in those days I was really superstitious about talking about what I was doing before I did it. And actually, it's one of the reasons there's so much confusion about those years, because I always used to say we when it was really I. And so, like, you know, it just got confusing about authorship and where things came from and what really was happening and sequence and all that stuff. But anyway, I wasn't thinking about that at the time. I just told her I was doing this class. It's like I knew when I went to Fresno and proposed this women's class, I knew what I was really wanting to do. But I didn't say that to the head of the art department. I just said, you know, I've gone through 10 years of professional practice. I went to school with all these women. None of them made it into professional practice. I'd like to try and help young women traverse this course from school to professional practice and be able to succeed. Well, that sounded good and pretty benign, right? I didn't say, you know, I want to create an alternative art making. That's what I said. So I told Mimi a little more. I told her, you know, that I was working with these young women. I was trying to help them be artists, which was true. And she got interested. She said and I arranged for her to give a lecture in Fresno, and she came up. And she came to the studio. Mimi always had a real gift in terms of critique. I have a gift in terms of helping people find their voice and their content. But Mimi was always better than I was once that happened. And so she came to the studio and she gave a lot of really good input to the young women. And then she and Paul and a bunch of the CalArts people came for our show. In fact, I didn't know this for years. There was one piece in the show. It was a big stuffed piece made by a young woman named Jan Lester. And it was a prone female form with a mirrored face. And there was a big vulva, sewn vulva. And apparently John Baldessari put his boot into the vulva, which I guess should have, if I noticed it, which I didn't see, I guess it kind of reflected the attitude towards the feminist art program that would later manifest itself at CalArts, where they tried to erase its history. I notice only now they've claimed it. But anyway, so Mimi and Paul proposed to me that I bring my program to CalArts. And I mean, I didn't plan to stay in Fresno indefinitely, that's for sure. You know, I had wanted a place that was like close enough to LA so I could commute, but far enough away so I had psychic privacy. And Fresno was perfect for that. And, you know, and they offered to let some of the girls, the students, come to CalArts, you know, and Minnie helped them prepare their portfolios. By that time, I was ready to start the next phase of my imagery, which was Through the Flower, the Through the Flower paintings, and then The Great Ladies, where I was trying to figure out how to use my form language to express women's history. And so I moved to a place in Pacoima. Okay. All right, so where were we? CalArts.
CalArts and 70, I think it's like fall 71.
Yeah, well, summer. Over the summer of 71, I packed up, and so did a lot of the students who had gotten in. Now, you have to realize that these are, most of them are Fresno girls, right? You know, so they're about to be admitted to this high-class art school, and, you know, there was definitely a sort of culture issue, you know, in terms of them coming there. But, you know, what they lacked in sophistication, they made up in energy, and they were a lively group. So we all arrived at CalArts. It was still the beginning of the school. There was no hierarchy. There was a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of openness. But the school at that time had been meeting at a convent in Burbank because the campus wasn't ready. And the campus wasn't ready when we got there. So we were meeting in people's houses and in Mimi's house. I mean, we were meeting and starting, you know, like people later call it consciousness raising in terms of the classes, but that's not what I call it, because consciousness raising only has one purpose, which is to raise your consciousness. What the practice that I developed in Fresno is what I call content search, where you look at your experiences as potential content for art, and it has a particular goal. It's not about healing yourself, it's about, or even coming to consciousness, it's about finding the subject matter for your art and finding your own voice and your own path. And so we started doing that, and we're going to have this really fully equipped studio, budget, money. I mean, it was the first time historically that a mainstream art school ever devoted resources to the needs of women, because art school is inherently, curriculum in art schools is inherently biased against women. It privileges form over content. It privileges certain types of techniques and materials, although some of that is broken down now. But at that time, it hadn't broken down at all. And, you know, painting and sculpture and video and performance were art, and fiber was craft. I had started putting together, first by myself and then with my students, an early art historical library, slide library of work by women. You know, whenever I would travel, like when I was in Vancouver, I discovered Emily Carr and brought back slides. And we were going to have an actual art historian to do that work for us, to continue to build the library. And the first feminist art historian was Paula Harper. And she made this suggestion when we were talking about what we were going to do. We weren't on campus, so we had to do something. We had to figure out where we were going to work. And she made this suggestion about a house. And so we found this house, and now we have the Fresno girls and CalArts students. And, you know, the Fresno girls had gone through already a year, and they knew that they were going to be required to work full time and to be focused and to push beyond their limits and stuff like that. But there were a lot of privileged young art students who came in from CalArts, and a lot of them had a hard time with these requirements. You know, it was too hard, it was too difficult, it was too demanding, blah, blah, blah. Of course, you know, you don't change history unless you work really hard. That's the way it is. Sorry, girls, you know. So you were a little uncomfortable, too bad. Anyway. We rented this house on Mariposa and set to work. The house was very derelict, and set to work. You know, girls had to learn, the ones who hadn't gone through the Fresno program, a lot of them had to learn how to use power tools, how to build, how to spackle walls, how to, you know, they did everything, and they learned from it. And it was, again, about learning to be a professional. You know, I built my own studios. I mean, I knew what it was involved, and I was trying to train the young women because I thought there were a lot of reasons that women weren't succeeding at that point. And a lot of it had to do with how they were brought up or weren't in terms of skills, abilities, courage, confidence. Hello, I'm Mary. I mean, I still get it when I go do seminars at colleges, you know. Drives me crazy, these meek little voices. And I, you know, I've developed techniques to empower them, and that was part of what the program was about, not only helping them find their voices, develop skills, but also empowerment. And learning their history was one very, very effective way, path towards empowerement. So this was the fall of 1971, and Woman House opened in January in 1972. It was up for a month. Thousands of people saw it. It was the first female-centered installation. Actually, I suppose, when was Nikki de Saint-Phalle's Han?
16, earlier.
Earlier, but we didn't know a thing about it.
Right.
So I would say, you know, in America, because definitely Han was a sort of counterpart.
And can you talk about when the performances happened? Because there were many attendees, and I heard on tape somewhere, I have it with Peter Plagans talking about actually attending the Women House performances and saying, yeah, I get it. I understand what women were fighting against, and I saw those performances too.
Really?
Yes. Explain what the installations were and the performance.
Okay, well, first of all, the performance, I started doing performance with the Fresno girls. They all say to me, Judy, we're in our 50s or 60s. We're not, you know, I'm like, you'll always be girls to me. I know it's terrible, but anyway. But, you know, we used to do that. I mean, we had to sing Judy Chicago and the California Girls. We did a whole performance thing about that. Anyhow, so I started doing performance with them in Fresno because I found it to be a very effective pedagogical tool, again, to help them find content and also to help them deal with aspects of their personalities that impeded their art making, i.e. fear of being aggressive. So like, for example, when I would do the Cock and Come play with them, most of them didn't have any problems playing the female part, but when they had to play the male part, they ran into all kinds of psychological barriers in terms of being assertive and aggressive, the ways in which women were taught to internalize that was dangerous. And also, when I was a little kid, I used to do plays on my backyard with all the kids in the neighborhood. So I had a bent in that direction. And, you know, because new options had opened up as a result of the women's movement in the early 70s, I was thinking about whether or not I wanted to, like, you know, I never thought I could become a theater director. I mean, it was just out of the question for women of my generation. So, you know, I was also trying out different things. That's what I talked about before. You know, do I want to stop making objects? Do I want to go into performance? You know, stuff like that. So when we got to Woman House, I continued that. I had a performance workshop in the house for everybody who wanted to work on performance, and a number of the Fresno girls and some of the new students did want to do that. And in fact, you know, it was interesting, in 2001, 30 years after Woman House, Donald and I were invited to do a project at Western Kentucky University in Bowling Green, called At Home. It was revisiting the subject of the home with male and female students. It was the 30-year anniversary of Woman House. And they wanted to do performances too. But I wouldn't do it then because, you know, in the 1970s, there wasn't a lot of performance, particularly not feminist performance. In 2001, there was 30 years of feminist performance. And so to take a group of unsophisticated kids in Kentucky and try and come up with anything new or original, was way more of a challenge than it was in the early 70s when all this was new. It was completely new. And I think people who came to see Woman House realized they were seeing something completely new and radical, particularly the performances. I still remember Maurice Tuckman's, because, you know, we did performances in the living room. And people had to sit on the floor around the performance space. And Maurice Tuckman, you know, who was the curator at LA County, he came with his girlfriend. I always say Blossom Dearie, but it wasn't that. It was something like that, blonde. And they're sitting there, and the Cotton Come play is on. And he's getting so uptight, he's squeezing her thigh in rhythm to the play. Will you help me do the dishes? And he's getting more and more agitated. I'm thinking, oh, her poor leg, you know. And, I mean, he just was, like, apoplectic. But, I mean, those were the days also that there was such new content. A lot of times, like when we did Ablutions, this performance in Guy Dill's studio, which was the first performance on rape, with rape tapes that I had made in the Bay Area, there was complete silence. Nobody said anything about it for 6 months. I mean, it was so new, this subject matter. All the subject matter was new. And so there was a certain amount of shock value. There was also not knowing how to deal with it, which actually provided space for it to have an impact, because people, you know, they hadn't figured out strategies yet, like erase it, like CalArts, the History of Feminist Art programs, or, you know, Museum of Modern Art, reinstall your galleries without any mention of the feminist art movement, and then women suddenly appear in the 1980s as if by magic. So, I mean, they hadn't figured out strategies. There was a real window of opportunity and space for new ideas then. And, you know, then in February 1972, there was a conference at the Corcoran that brought together all the artists, art historians, writers together who were, like, agitating. There were a couple hundred people. And, I mean, there was an explosion because, you know, none of us knew each other and we didn't know everything that was going on around the rest of the country. It also marked the decline of my relationship with Miriam.
And how come Miriam didn't participate in Woman House, or did she?
Oh, she participated in Woman House. She did the Dollhouse. Okay. Yeah, she participated, absolutely. She didn't participate in the performance workshop at all. That was mine. Mimi Strength was painting and, you know, sculpture, and she, again, brought her generous spirit in terms of critiquing to help the young women in who were doing painting and painting, like Mira Shore. You know, there were certain people who worked more with her. You know, I worked with the more, I'd suppose, radical wing of the feminist art program.
And Sheila DeBretville designed the catalog.
Yeah, by the time we got there, the feminist art program brought into CalArts an entirely new consciousness. It wasn't just that we had this space once we got, you know, on the campus and stuff like that. It was that it was the first time. I mean, this you have to understand, an institution is now committing itself to supporting a program for women, run, designed, run, and for women, that had implications for the rest of the campus. You know, other women in other departments took permission from that. Once we got on the campus, there was a big scandal because a girl had gotten raped in one of the dorm rooms, a student, and Bella Lewinsky organized this big conference, and, you know, everybody stood up and testified, and, you know, people were talking about what they were experiencing in the school, and, you know, there was an energy towards addressing this and bringing it out in the open, you know, that simply disappeared after that. And then the second year was horrible for me. By the end of the first year, I'd already tendered my resignation, and I just had to work out my 2-year contract. And I gave Mimi she was in the studio with most of the students. I was in a basement, an airless basement room, with those students who wanted to continue to work with me. And when I left CalArts, I left everything. I left my program, my students, my slides, everything I left, and started all over again yet again.
Do you want to talk about the beginning of the just very briefly about the founding of the Women's Building with Sheila de Bretville and Arlene Ray?
Well, I don't know if you need to do that. It's not, that doesn't really relate to the Getty.
It's
and
it's
we have to be done in 15 minutes.
Right. Okay, so then let's go back to the Peace Tower.
Yeah, let's tell us a little bit about the development of the idea for the Peace Tower and your involvement.
Oh, that was Mark. That, I mean, that had nothing to do with me.
But you helped in the...
Well, they're actually this John Train just wrote to me from the Getty. He's, you know, Research Institute, and he's doing, I guess, a show. And he had read that there were paintings that were done by artists, about 200 paintings that were exhibited on the Peace Tower. And he somehow got the idea that I had done a painting. And I'm like, I have a pretty good memory, and I don't think I did a painting. I ran a jackhammer. And he, and then Andrew told me that there was this photographer who rented an apartment above the Peace Tower and who did photographs of the whole time. And Andrew said he had a crush on me because there were hundreds and hundreds of pictures of me. I mean, I don't even know anything about it. So John Train said some of the pictures, and it was, I mean, there I am running the jackhammer. And I said to him, yeah, I'm wearing purple blue jeans. And he said, because I remembered that. And he said, well, because they were black and white. He didn't know that. So that just, you know, was a little colorful. But, you know, Mark was living next door in Pasadena. And he, you know, we were all anti-war. And so we all went down there to help him. But, you know, I didn't do a painting or anything. I just, like, helped build the Peace Tower.
Okay. Then, will you tell us about the change of your name and then the taking out of the ad in for art form?
Sure. Although you know the story, right?
Yeah.
Okay. When I went to California from Chicago, I brought with me an incredible Chicago accent. And from the time I first started showing with Rolf in 1963, he used to call me Judy Chicago. And he wanted me to change my name. But I did list my phone under the name Judy Chicago. You know, it was a period where there were a lot of artists who had underground names. Larry Bell was Ben Lux, Ed Richey was Eddie Russia, and we all listed our names in the phone book. You know, it's this kind of in thing. If you knew what our underground names were, you knew how to find us, right? And if you didn't, screw you. You shouldn't call me up anyway. So I have this underground name. I had a proto-feminist consciousness, as I said, even in college. And so even when I got married the first time, when I was 21, which I would have been, I still was in undergraduate school. I started showing, because I entered my first juried show right then when I was 21 and got into it. So, but I showed under my maiden name, which was Judy Cohen. I was telling them last night the stupidest things people have ever written about me. This one qualifies. I changed my name so my initials would be JC. That was really good, since my original initials were JC. Anyway, so, when I started, then I was showing the whole time I was married to Jerry, for the 2 years before he died, I showed under my own name, and then I started noticing that there were a lot of Cohens showing. So right before he got killed, I started using Gerowitz because it was more, you know, it was more singular, and then he died. So now I'm 23. I'm a widow. And people are coming up to me and saying, I know your parents. But they weren't my parents. They were Jerry's parents. So basically, I started feeling like I didn't have a name. And then towards the end of that era, you know, when I was like changing course and deciding to start down this other path and figuring out how to create a feminist art practice, I decided I want to symbolize it. And so I had a big show at Dexter Frankel's gallery at Cal State Fullerton. And I, at that point, legally changed my name. And on the wall, I wrote, you know, whatever I wrote, whatever, like, dramatic Black Pantherish kind of radical statement, you know, I divest myself of all names imposed upon me by, you know, it's so funny now, you know. I was like, did I ever think about how I think about it when I got older? No. And so it was projected on the wall, and I did a little ad in art form. And then at the same time, I had a show at the Jack Glenn Gallery in Corona Del Mar. Now, Jack, I showed that was the first and only time until for 30 years that any of the Fresno fans or Flesh Gardens were shown at that show. Of course, nothing sold. No silence, no reviews, nothing sold, which only reinforced my decision to go in a different direction. And so now I have even more things to store. So Jack's money came from his family developed the system of putting names on bowling shirts. So he had this idea of an ad for with me in the boxing ring. Now, mind you, this is the era of all the macho ads, the studs posters, all that stuff, all the Ferris guys are doing. And, you know, so I thought it was funny. It was kind of going to be a takeoff on the Ferris boys, right, you know? So he wanted Lloyd to be my second, and I'm like, not, I'm not doing that. So Chuck Arnaldi and Laddie Dill and Guy Dill, those guys, when they came out of Chouinard, they helped me on some of my atmospheres. So, you know, I knew them, and I knew Chuck had this girlfriend, Alana. And so I asked her to be my second. I thought that was more appropriate, actually. So Jack and Alana and I go down to the Main Street gym in downtown Los Angeles, and Jack has had my name emblazoned with the process of his family on a sweatshirt. And, you know, this is way before there were any female boxers, and those guys were just, like, stupefied at the boxing ring. The Main Street gym. So he sent it out as the announcement for his show. And you remember Art Forum was here. So Phil Leader called him up, and he wanted him to take out a full-page ad in Art Forum. And Jack didn't want to spend the money, whatever it was, $700. So Phil had started this section on politics. And so he just decided to print it anyway, so he printed it. And for the next number of years, whenever I'd go around the country to artist studios, there would be the damn, and women artists particularly, there'd be the boxing ring ad on their walls, and there'd be, and of course, male artists for years say, wow, you with Judy Chicago, you want to box? I mean, like, it was a parody. It was a satire. I didn't know the first thing about boxing. Anybody who really knew me knew it was, like, what it was about. So, but the thing is that it signaled the moment that women were coming out fighting all around the country in terms of, we've had enough. You know, the art world has to change. There has to be, you know. June Wayne was doing her Joan of Arc seminars here, and, you know, there was the protest at the Whitney and with the eggs and the tampons, and, you know, there was the conference. So, I mean, the boxing ring ad happened to intersect with a moment in history that made it kind of iconic.
And Jerry McMillan was the photographer?
He was the photographer, yes.
Okay, one random thing. Where was the, when you first moved to Santa Monica at some point, didn't you live in a house with Frank Gehry designed? Where
yes,
was it?
It was on the corner of 4th and Pier. He hadn't designed it, he owned it. When Jerry died, we were living in Topanga Canyon, and he had an accident, and his car went over the cliff. And so I moved into an apartment that was a big, it was like a blue building. It was kind of a, it wasn't a modern, he wasn't working on it. It had a little apartment in the bottom, and there was a back, I guess, garage or something, back outbuilding that was my studio. And I lived there for, let's see, that was 63, Jerry died in 63. I think I lived there until I graduated, until after my master show. I think that's when I moved out. And then Joe Good and I lived next door to each other in a house that Ralph Nelson either owned or had rented and sublet it to us over on Western. Joe was just talking about it. And then after that, I moved into Pasadena. And then Kingsburg, then Pacoima while I was teaching at Kell Arts, then Santa Monica again. Oh, really?
Yeah. So the last few minutes that we have, well, maybe we can talk about some of Glenn's questions and, you know, the disappearing environments.
And the Feather Room, yeah. And he also wanted to talk about the artists. See, that was the one, actually it was seeing Glenn's questions that made me realize the sort of hidden content in those disappearing environments. You think about the feather room, okay, it was an effort to soften, dematerialize a space that for me was not welcoming. Although Rolf was, but I mean in general, as a symbol of the art world. And the dry ice, there were two dry ice pieces. One was on a corner, it was just an empty lot. And then the other one was in the Century City Mall. And again, it took 40 years until Jenna Didier from Materials and Applications, when I spoke to her about restaging one of the dry ice environments, she talked about the anti-monumentality message in it and how that had become of interest to younger architects who were reacting against kind of this incredible monumentality in, you know, these buildings that have been dominated the architectural vocabulary in the last couple of decades. And so, I mean, it's been interesting to me the way in which a lot of this work that was, you know, had an impact but wasn't really understood is finally being comprehended. And so when I was thinking about the feather room, the dry ice pieces, and the atmospheres in relationship to these questions, that's what I realized, is that they had certain things in common. They were in terms of this impulse to soften, dematerialize, disappear, erode the obstacles, the physical and institutional obstacles that I was coming up against over and over again. And the other thing I think is about the collaborative nature of them. And like, even though I worked with a lot of the guys were not that interested in collaboration. There were ego struggles, they had difficulties. For me, it was completely natural. And I was thinking about the art events that I organized in Brookside Park, the one where Jim Terrell made off with the turkey. Same thing, you know, I said before, I come from a political household, and my father was a labor organizer, and there used to be these discussions in our houses, and he always included everybody, including the women. And there was something about that spirit of inclusiveness that I grew up with, that I brought into the art community, but it was not welcomed there. I mean, I would do this all the time. I would organize these events and invite people to participate, but it was always like, you know, kind of uncomfortable for some of the people. Even though they may have enjoyed themselves, it was just a gesture of inclusiveness that was kind of contrary to the thrust of the art world, if you could excuse the expression. And, you know, of course, collaboration became something much more embraced by younger artists, but all I'm talking about really is that my impulses towards collaboration preceded the dinner party and the birth project and my more formal collaborative projects, but of course, I didn't run into the same resistance among women to collaborating that I would run into with the men, particularly male artists I tried to collaborate with. It, you know, because it was contrary to the competition, the competitive nature of the art world, with which I was also never comfortable.
So would you say that some of those collaborations in the park and with other male artists in Pasadena and wherever else, if it had been formalized, that they couldn't have ever happened, and it was the informal nature of the structure, that it was not for a specific place or institution?
Yes, I'm sure, is that it was outside the structure of institutions. Although, you know, Rolf supported the feather room, but Rolf was unusual. I don't think I realized at the time how unusual he was in his support of my work and his showing my work and all that in support of me. I don't think I realized it at the time, you know, but looking back at it, when you think about, you know, Ferris had an all-male stable. I'm sure if you looked at most, Dwan had an all-male stable, you know, and that Rolf was probably one of the few dealers who had any women in his gallery.
Describe the feather environment.
Well, it was actually very funny. The feather room was in the same space that I did my solo shows, Rainbow Picket and Sunset Squares. It was that same space, his first gallery. And we we had inflatable white walls, so the you know, the corners, everything disappeared. You couldn't tell where the space began and ended. And then the room was filled with feathers, speaking of spraying. And what we never thought about was that the chicken feathers, that many chicken feathers, would smell like hell. So I had to spray some kind of disinfectant. I can still remember the people shoveling the feathers into the air while I'm spraying, trying to get the smell out. I mean, it was kind of like the law of unintended consequences. Whoever thought about having so many pounds of chicken feathers that they would smell. And also, you know, I was like getting donations. I mean, because I didn't have any money. I was talking about that before. But you know, like when I did the dry ice pieces, I would, you know, I got all that dry ice donated. You know, I mean, I was learning that you have to find support for your work. But I tended to go, I had to go a lot, other than the grin scenes, out of the art world for it.
But what was the Butterfly for Oakland?
That was,
and how does it relate to what they're doing?
The Butterfly for Oakland was the last of a series of many fireworks pieces. It was the only one that was commissioned. The rest of them I did myself, starting in the late 60s around California and then up the West Coast in a series called Smoke Holes, where I put colored smoke and orifices all up and down the coast. But I was commissioned by the Pasadena Museum to do one. That was the one Chuck and Laddie and Guy all worked on. And again, you know, it was the same thing. John Copeland's was there then. And then, you know, I don't know, they wrote this really demeaning description of it. It was more like a circus than a work of art. Got me really upset. But then Oakland Museum was doing an outdoor sculpture show, and they invited me to do an atmosphere on the shores of Lake Merritt. That was the biggest atmosphere I ever did, biggest fireworks piece I ever did. And then I wanted, of course, to get bigger, and I couldn't get the support to get any bigger. And so I stopped doing those. I mean, that's what kept happening. I kept trying, you know, I was getting bigger in my paintings. I was getting big, doing this big sculpture. I just come up against, you know, like I just couldn't go any farther. I couldn't get the support until I started down this alternative path of trying to tell the story of women's history. And then I found a lot of people who were interested in what I was doing, and I was able to build support for my ideas, which was the first time.
And how will Pomona be restaging the Butterfly for Oakland?
Well, it's a butterfly form. It's on a football field. Donald keeps saying Judy's blowing up a football field, so I guess in terms of, you know, what I've been talking about trying to counter the prevailing paradigm, you know, masculine paradigm, I suppose there's something truly ironic about staging it in a football field. It's almost the size of the football field. And it's like picking up where I left off in terms of I stopped with that imagery. I couldn't go farther with it. And there have been new fireworks since then. So yeah, we were in fact out there doing a test with some of the new fireworks that is allowing, for example, veining in the butterfly, allowing for a type of fireworks that is gonna make it look almost like the butterfly wings are fluttering. So, you know, it's allowing me to make another step aesthetically with this work that I left then because I couldn't go any farther. Also, I was studying to be a pyrotechnician, and it's the only time in my career that I was sexually harassed out of something I wanted to do.
You know, in your discussions with Glenn, to realize like the scope of what the performance festival is going to be, you know, in January for 10 days, and these performances everywhere, and, you know, restagings, reinterpretations. Can you maybe give us some thoughts about that?
About the whole performance festival, or just what it is for me?
I would love if there was some, you know, if we could get a little bit of a soundbite about the performance festival now, and coming back to these works, you know, thinking about that for so many of them, there was little to no documentation.
Right. Well, you know, my atmospheres, there's very little writing about my atmospheres, about my fireworks pieces. And, you know, of course, then I see other artists, you know, doing fireworks as if there's no precedent for it. So it's great for me to have the beginnings of documentation of work that has existed in another land. I mean, it's one of the things I'm so grateful to the Getty for undertaking Pacific Standard Time in general, because of the fact that, as I've been saying, for a long time, New York was very hostile to my work. But ever since the dinner parties, permanent housing at the Brooklyn Museum, it's like my California roots are being erased. And I'm really not for that. I'm very glad for Pacific Standard Time in general, the numbers of shows, museum shows I'm going to be in, and the opportunity that Glenn has provided for picking up where I left off and being able to not only know that the work will be documented, but also have a chance as an artist to get the level of a level of institutional support that I never got before to be able to go on. And so I think it's going to be pretty exciting. I mean, I know some of the pieces are being restaged. I've actually tried to go somewhere that I wasn't able to go before in both the dry ice environment and the butterfly for Pomona, in the sense that in working with materials and applications, something that Glenn is the one who engineered. I mean, one of the things I've been understanding is how his vision has been underpinning and guiding what is a huge undertaking of performances and events around Southern California, coordinated with the museum exhibitions, that is allowing a whole aspect of Southern California practice to become visible because of how the additive factor of seeing them all together will enable a historic reading that was never possible before. So in terms of the dry ice environment, materials and applications is an architectural, alternative architectural group. And what I've tried to do is find a way to merge the original impulse of the dry ice piece with what they're interested in terms of participation of artists, designers, and architects. So what we've done is take the parameters of the dry ice piece. That is, the original dry ice piece had 9 ziggurats, 91 blocks, 37 tons of dry ice, 91 blocks of dry ice. And this time we're going to do a workshop and teach people about handling dry ice. And they're going to be able to do models instead of just mimicking what we did. We're going to ask them to invent structures using 91 blocks of dry ice, whatever kind of structure they want. And as one of the principals, Oliver Hess, of Materials and Applications said, which I thought was very insightful, it's going to be an opportunity to work with a material that has both weight and mass, but has no inherent structure because it will disappear. And how do you design for a material like that? And that's what we're going to do, which is a very different way of approaching the dry ice environment, because what I was interested in is creating this fog, this pink fog that disappeared the commerce. I do think there's something wonderful about the fact that if plans go as they are developing, we'll have an opportunity to disappear an art fair.
Well, that's a perfect place to stop.